Factory dwellers, welcome to the Jupiter 2 Ultimate Doodah, whatever. Fantastic Lost in Space Saucer Grand Finale. Yes, it would be technically update number 14, but it is the Grand Finale. I think 6 months are slightly over to complete because of some problems we ran into. The landing gear just didn't quite work out. Then I had to take time to develop my own landing gear and all sorts of fun stuff. But as, you know, science would have it, we prevailed. We did prevail. At much cost, I'm at least 10 years older physiologically than I was before I began. But we're there, you know. So we got it. We got it all set up. We're going to show you. I'm very pleased at this. It taught me a few new tricks. Every project does, but this one was particularly fun that way. Gotta say, one of the most complicated builds ever. I've built starships that were much bigger, had more circuitry and all that, but this one, well, about wore me out, man. And I'm gonna take 2 weeks off after this before we begin the next project, which is the Galileo 7 kit by Randy Cooper. Good size, about a foot long, lots of doodahs in that. Still got to discuss a couple points with the client before we really start doing it, because I will not start the project until we've got it finalized. We know what we're doing. So that's a message to the client. As far as this client, George, you got the best I could do. I spent the last few days trying to take care of the light leaks and all that. And along the horizontal edge, no light leak whatsoever. However, whenever you have a removable top with this kit, if you go underneath and start really looking, you will find some little light leaks. But pretty much inevitable. He even said, go ahead and seal it shut. But I'm like, man, I just spent, 6 months detailing the hell out of this thing. And you'll never see it. I mean, because really, from the door and the front viewport, you never see three-quarters of it. I mean, that was the problem with this metal one from Mobius that they sold, which is great. Metal hull, bah, bah, bah. But you never see most of it. So I was like, no, I mean, if you can live with a few gaps, then you can open it up and do it. And I did close it up with the magnetic lock to do the very best, but even the magnets can't seem to bring it up. It's almost like you'd have to re-grid all the structurals inside at some point. And then, no matter what happens, when you start putting a little torsion, I remember I said that name, that word, torsion, even the slightest thing starts deviating the fit. And at first, when you first get the kit, it sort of fits, not perfectly, but pretty good. By the time you're done building it and altering and modding it to the max. So the magnets helped a lot. I mean, I got to say, I've got, I'd say 90% closure, perfection, but I couldn't get the rest. I drove myself crazy. And then when I added a magnet down the line, it would make it worse. Because what you start having is the torsion starts to get tight and you get a pucker. So you put one over here. And you get one over there. It was like a catch 22, no matter what I did, you know, that physics wise, that extra whatever it is, you know, quarter of an inch or whatever, it's got to come somewhere. It's got to go somewhere. You can't get rid of it. So again, short of ceiling, got to live with it. But to have the opportunity to be able to open and close the hull and see all that detail, I think is well worth a couple little gaps. You can only see if you go underneath and go, oh, he missed the spot. You know, hey, such is life. Many thanks to some of the people that contributed. Elliot Brown, who Fedortron.com, who I mention a lot because Elliot's my buddy, and on top of that, he's also a guy who contributes to almost every project. He created the terrain feature, and he created the sand dune, which I used one of, and then I got some volcanic rocks. I didn't want it to be overly done. I wanted it simple. And to Murphy Peoples, who sent in some stuff that I ended up not using most of it, but the plate is his, the stainless plate. So thank you, Murphy, on that. Ooh, chair just dropped. I think I gained an ounce or two. Quit smoking, but started eating more. Yes. And yes, I quit smoking, and it's been over a month now, and I don't know if you could tell, my voice is better. I was kind of going, Lord, become male version, you know, and that's done. Also, a big thank you to Chuck Brooks, who built, I think, every one of these, except Steve Smith, built the Spindrift. And that was sent in by Gene Davis, very kindly, because I was looking, you know, YouTube one night, trying to get away from this project. And I saw they had a little thing going about these little minis. I love miniatures. I absolutely love them. And they showed some really cool stuff. I mean, a Jupiter 2 about the size of a quarter with lighting. And we got talking, and I said, hey, do you mind sending these in just, you know, so I can steal them? You'll never get them. But no. So I can just show them along, you know, with a big Jupiter 2. I thought it'd be kind of cool showing little minis and the big one. And he was kind enough. Next day, it was here. So thank you very much, Gene Davis. Chuck Brooks, excellent work. Steve Smith, excellent work. And the amazing part of it is these little tiny things are lit. And I swear, one of them is barely bigger than the battery, especially those little Jupiter 2s. And it's a C-57D and the flying sub, the Spindrift, and the Jupiter 2. And on some of them, you have the extended leg version and the retracted version. I just think they're really cool, and I'll show you that. I just thought it was worth a segment on the show for something that I found particularly cool one night. What else? We have some toys in the background, whatever. I may have the energy and time to create a green screen thing I've been thinking about with this. There's limitations because you can use it as a prop, but then you've got a green screen over the scenery and all that. But it's already on a stand and it's somewhat elevated from the rock a little bit. So you can slip a green screen thing. If you know about green screen, you know how that's done. Also, let's see, other people to thank. Ed Holt, who didn't quite get the landing gear right, but his hatch door is very, very cool. I had some issues with it, tweaked it up, and got it working. But he deserves a mention because he did give it his best shot, I think. And Doug, the base guy across the street, he created a wood base and all that out of really nice oak. And he gave me a very good price on it, and all I got to thank him. Randy Newbert from Voodoo FX, my bud, created the sound unit that had inside the chip, he had put in DVD quality sound. Although, you know, it's not super loud, the clarity is much better because he did that. So thank you, Randy. The project, you know, is not always just me. I get things from people I know do them really well. And then I immerse it in the project, you know. So anyways, like I said, I want to keep my energy for showing what I'm going to show. And it's going to take a little time. There's a lot of stuff to show. I also want to do a segment and show you these great little minis so I can send them back. Because I'm sure by now he's like, what do you do? Feed them to the dog? What? You know, so no, we don't want to do that. So let's move on.
1 eternity later.
Hello. Okay, for the happy, fun segment, I wanted to show these. These were submitted by Gene Davis. Chuck Brooks created all of them, except Steve Smith is responsible for the Spindrift, which has a little bit of weathering. This is a quarter to give you an idea of the size we're talking about here. These are really amazing in my book. Beautiful paintwork. I know some wearing gloves. I don't know if this is acrylic or an ammo or whatever, but if you're handling a piece that's been completed, it's always a good idea, especially if you don't know the base or whatever, and I don't care what kind of base it is. You really shouldn't handle any kind of model once it's completed without these or having very, very clean hands. Now, here's the fun part about these, and I'm trying to do this without causing it too much stress. They're all lighted. Check that out. And this one's actually got a little fusion core thingy going. And what I'm going to do, and then go from there. Here's Steve Smith's Spindrift. Steve Smith's a very good modeler. I've actually hired him to do a couple models for me because I don't have time to build for me, guys. I just don't. Very nice detailing and all that. I think this one actually even has, yes, a little interior cabin. And I certainly hope this thing's focusing pretty well. The lighting's not good right now, but you get the concept. Little tiny, oh God, magnetic wire. Guys, magnetic wire, really? In this case, I suppose it's applicable, but I know a lot of people have said that magnetic wire works and all that. My experience is if you want to have short circuits, yeah, go ahead and use it, okay? There is 30 gauge that is much more dependable and as small as probably you need. But in this case, I can see it being applicable. Now, these guys is what really nailed it for me. Beautiful little glossy thing. First, I thought it was a Johnny Lightning. But apparently it comes from the derelict kit, which I have never been shown. And I'm trying to keep it left is right is left, backward rules. And check this out. Like I said, the battery's almost as big as the Jupiter 2. And when it's lit, it's really something. And then, of course, there's the retracted gear version. And I'm trying to not make these fall apart on me. And then there's Chuck Brooks. Remember, all these except the Spindrifts are Chuck Brooks, who apparently is a very talented fellow. Gorgeous paintwork. I mean, this is just spot on. Very, very nice. I really love what I see. I wouldn't mind having one of these for myself. But then what we're going to do now is we're going to turn the lights low and do a little pan on each one with all its lighting. I think they're awesome, and I thought it'd be a fun little segment. Okay, first off, I've got the lights down a bit, but I want you to be able to see the outline and all that. Here's the Flying Sub. Now, the Flying Sub is one of my favorites. It's got all the lighting, the search lights, even interior lights, and I'll show you, it even has an interior. There's your engine lights. Okay. Enough playtime. Now, here's what really got me about this one. Ooh, I'm trying to be ever so delicate. Full interior detailing. I mean, look at that. Wow. Very impressive. The fusion wall. I mean, I've built the monogram size ones of these with all this detailing. But, oh my God, I am so impressed with this work. That is just amazing. Love this piece. Flying Sub was always one of my big-time favorites. But, I mean, look, even the hexagonal floor. I mean, just amazing. So we'll let this one over here running in the background. Sorry, guys, if I use up your batteries, but you sent me extra, so I figured you wanted me to give you a good show. The C57D also. Whole lot of fun. Whole lot of fun. These things are so tiny. If I drop one on camera, I'm sure to die of a heart attack, and that's it. Papa Smurf dies, horrible, and Daytona Man Beach artist passes away from shock and grief. So obviously C57D wasn't lighted, but it did have engine effects. Let me get this. I'm trying to get this in focus, guys. Look at that. How freaking cool is that? A little bit of a fusion effect going there. Wow. Highly impressive. Beautiful little thing, you know, from a side profile. I can just hear the id monster now. Wow. That's just way cool. Well done, Chuck. Very nice. Let's take a look at Steve. Steve has a partial interior in here, but the lighting's really cool. Let me see. Oop. There it is. Little switches. There you go. And these are very much what I would call TV or movie prop quality. Seriously. On the Millennium Falcon, if I recall, there were some very small versions. Look at that. Ooh, pulsating. Just like some of the bigger ones that I've built. And I believe this is TSDS's effect. Or it might not be. I don't know. But I know Henry had a hand in this before he passed. And this is a lovely piece. Just lovely. And yes, he does have a partial injection. I'm trying to be really gentle with these things. Oh, very nice. Very nice. Like this one. I like them all. The Jupiter 2 and the Flying Sub are my personal favorites, but they're all nice. And, of course, there's another C-5070, same kind of effect on it. Let me see. Flexing them a little bit gets it open, but if I flex it too much, I just bought it. I am sure of that. And this one also has that really cool sort of fusion sort of effect. I just love that. You just want to play with them, and of course, that's probably not a good idea. The Jupiter 2. This thing just kills me. My finger will probably obliterate most of the lighting, but here, let me try to get it lined up correctly here. Of course, there is a seam gap lighting thing, but you know what? Tough. Enjoy. Look at that. Let me see. I got to get real back here for the focus. There we go. Good. Close the gap. God, I wish I got mine that good. There's your lighting. There's your cabin lighting. And look at that. Little bit of fusion core lighting. And this is the retracted. It even has, the way you did it, it has gear lighting. Oh, my God. That is just, how can I say? It's adorable. It's so nice. It's Smurfy sweet. Oh, I love that piece. They were having some little doodah going on one night, and they were talking and showing these off with smoke effects, and I was looking at them, and I go, man, these are super cool. And I think, Chuck, you should maybe consider building a few for somebody. I'm going to try and get a hold of him. I think he already sent me some info of how you get a hold of him if you want one. I'm not going to tell him what to charge, but I think these are freaking cool. And again, the Fusion, this is a retracted version. So he's done both versions on the saucers. So let me sweep down low here and give you a look. All right, so this little sweep. There you go. There's the Flying Sub. And you've seen how small these are, but the detail is very high-end. A little Jupiter, too. Look at those fusion cores. The thing's having trouble focusing because they're so small. There's our fella here. Little Jupiter's the Spindrift with its effects. Let me get that a little bit better lined up. Everybody deserves a big hand here. Steve Smith and Chuck Brooks and Gene Davis, thank you so much for trusting me with these little treasures. And that is what they are. Isn't that fun? I can almost hear squeaky voices. And there you go. That's our little treat film. Somebody actually was kind enough to send them to me. Gene Davis, trust me, with not absconding them and running off to Mexico, and I do appreciate it. And now let's move on. So here she is sitting up on the world-famous rising and lowering table. This is the Jupiter 2. It's got the finish that I like to use, which is a weathered titanium, German chrome, and stainless steel finish. It's sort of a blend with some font dust. It's not something amazing or, national security level, but that's the one thing I've never shared exactly how I do it, although a talented airbrush guy could probably figure out how I do it. It's just something that's trademark signature. And the way I do the hulls on the Jupiter 2s, rather than just somebody doing it shiny silver, which I've always found extremely dull. I'm going to actually go around with the camera. I know you guys love my camera work, but it's really the only way to get everything in there without having to take a whole lot of shots for just one angle. I tried that earlier in some takes, and it didn't work very well. We'll get all the stuff going. I will use a steel tripod system to show the landing gear and things along that nature. And, of course, for the interior, I had to do a little sweep. Fortunately, the ceiling that goes above it really blocks a lot. Now, you can see it with the human eye if you just cradle yourself. But for a camera thing, it's a little difficult. One of the shortcomings of the kit in my book. Let's move on. This plane is outfitted with many, many features, which includes the landing gear, the hatch, fusion core, the main, which is the internal lighting and all the goodies. The interior, as far as arches and certain spot lightings, cryo, as in the auxiliary cryo tubes, which I've got with RGBs. The pod, which is the actual little space pod in the back, which has a pre-launch alarm thing going, very much like Alien, when all the flashies are going. The exterior, which is the lighting for the landing gear, and then the speed on the fusion control, as you'll see. And then sound effects, like the motor. Let's take a look at what the gear looks like. The gear will go up and down. And then when it's sitting here on top of the rock formation, it kind of looks like it's hovering pre-landing. It's kind of interesting. The hatch also opens and closes. I don't know if this is a good angle to show that. Let me see. I'll try. There you go. And there's a little interior hallway in there, and you can open up the door on the other end to see inside the ship. But the rest is pretty much inside. Jubilee is not the most featured thing, and there's sort of a pause and pulsing thing. And different speeds. Let me turn off the lights and we'll see how that looks. There you go, a little bit brighter. Let me see if I can move in here. Now this is, obviously off the tripod. Can't get too intense. But there's our passengers inside. Nicely framed. And again for that sort of hovering thing. cheap effect. Kind of fun. There's a lot of things you can do with this guy. There we go. Ooh, that's a very Lost in Space traditional. And let me see, what else do we have here? We have...
Here now is the Jupiter 2.
It's got a bit of a spiel with a whole lot of mixes and robot noises and little clips. Landing is very dependable with robotic servos.
Identify yourself.
Canadian name. Robot, so I'm rather proud of. Designed and now let me open up the top and give you a look at some of the fun stuff on the interior. Well, you're going to hear some whirring noises. Those are the motors driving some of the special effects. Now, I have to be mobile because it's the only way we get around. And here we go. Let me see if I can get this in here. There's your computer wall. I don't know if you can see. The tape reel right there is actually... Gosh, it's hard to tell here. It is motorized and you can see it running. The gyro itself is lighted, and has a motion. Several twinklies there.
There's our elevator section.
Now here's the back there is the let's see, the pod. That was actually supposedly the pod chamber. Sorry for the jerky. I know. Now the pod chamber has an alert launch status lighting. I thought was kind of cool. That was the client's request. The cryo tubes have a dimming feature that's offset with the wall dimming feature. Those nifty circuits are from Elliott Brown, the Fedoratron. Now, here's our little robot friend. It's really hard to make out, but our little robot buddy, if I can keep it in focus here, very difficult with anything that's going on, has lighting in his chest. There's a few blinkies in his chest. I don't know if you can make them out. Very tiny. And he also has fiber optics in his head in a triad pattern. That was a trick. Now, as we keep traveling around, hopefully I don't... In the front. And that's a lot of work right there, guys. And on the radar screens, we have a sweeping hand function. Kind of make it out right there. Got this thing. There we go. You can kind of make that out. See, it's this wall thing that gets in the way when you're trying to do some filming later. Whole lot of blinkies. The Major and Professor Robinson. The, let's see, those, that center console has that sort of a warbly effect. And see that sweep hand? Very cool. Rather elaborate. I usually don't get to do that much on this guy. But from the top, you can kind of make it out better. And then in the environmental station, you have that hostile kind of fuzzy guy. Right there. There's a lot of blinkies in this thing, let me tell you. And of course, backstage, there's a heck of a lot. Now, this is the way a real prop looks like without all the shiny bits backstage. Model building, like Elliott Brown was very accurate in saying, is very much like theater. Now, you've got the pretty side on stage, and then backstage is where the nuts and bolts are. And there are a whole lot of nuts and bolts in this guy. Circuit boards. I'd say a good third of a mile of wiring. Probably close to that in fiber optic. Lots of circuit boards, actually. Servos under the floor. Motors. There are 7 motors running all the effects in this thing. Pretty cool. Now, in the actual top section, there's not as much in the top. But there's the motor drive gear for the door. Edward Holt designed that. I had some issues with it. I kind of redid a little bit of the assembly. But we got it working. And there's the door hatch lighting. And the flashy on the top. And there's that magnetic lock system. The magnetic lock system is basically rare earth magnets, very powerful magnets, arranged in a way where I've got the best possible hold with them. But it's very hard to prevent all light leaks. You can prevent most of them. But the minute you get into doing a removable top, you do run into that. There's your umbilicae, which feeds from the top section to the bottom section, which tucks in. But like I said, it's a fun thing. Pretty much the ultimate toy, although I don't like to call my models toys. All right, so now in a little darker setting, I'm going to turn on everything. Now, in the last take when I showed you everything, I did not have the arches going. Now, the arches were quite the trick. Now, here's our standard here. This is what I just showed you. Now, the interior involved the arches. And that was clear cast parts. Something I could never do before was just to duplicate the lighting on the structurals inside, also known as the bulkheads, apparently, something I did not know, which gives you the nice, even interior lighting. That was another thing we had. Now here's another little doodah over here. I have this little latch, a little tricky to open, to remove that little door, so that when you have the hatch open from the exterior, you can proceed inside. I know my client has one of those little snake cameras, and he wanted to do something along that line. So you'll be able to go down this hallway and then way in there. And this is the kind of view you have. You have the V9 robot behind the Astrogator and a lot of the blinkies. Oh, and that's probably something else I missed. It's kind of hard to see. Again, that damn wall prevents you from seeing it. But along all the upper levels above the cryotubes, is that, oops, bamming into something, is those lovely chase effects all the way along the top. See? And again, that's something that you don't see because of the way this model is made with that roof section. You miss all that. Anyways. So that's the whole look, pretty much. And I'm not doing so good this time. I'm sorry. Getting tired. There's Mr. B9. I'm trying to get you a good look at that head. The headshot's kind of interesting. He does have some stuff structured in there. So, I hope you enjoyed the video. This really was the best way to show it. I wish I'd have done a little better, but... And there you can see a lot of the lighting's blacked out to prevent light leaks. Look at that. That's a show in itself right there. So that's our fella. I've got this one over here. The hatch sitting on something soft. I suggest the client do the same thing. Have a towel or whatever sitting by. And that's the microphone. And this is Papa Smurf. See ya! Oh, hello, boys and girls. Of course, it's got cameras everywhere. Yes, we're doing some last-minute checkups on this old Jupiter 2 here. Wait. Yes, I do quality control. You have to do quality control. These things have plutonium aboard. Maybe a little uranium. You never know. Cobalt? Who knows? Shh, it's a secret. Never had any major problems. Of course, there's that small country in Africa. No. I never said anything at all. Yeah, smoking? No, I'm not allowed to smoke anymore. Yes, he's pretty much a no-smoking policy. Although he had a little accident the other day. He started chewing all that nicotine gum and almost died. Back in the audience, I would have assassinated him for keeping me from smoking. I'm good with it. I'm good with it. Yes, it's all good. It's all good. So anyways, I've been checking out these systems and... it's all good, it's all good. How have you been? Yes, well, I was chewing nicotine gum, and then I chewed so much, I about blew my brains out, so that's not good either. Yes, that's looking good. So anyways, you know, the trouble with this leg is it's occasionally it comes down. Yes. Bastard. Thank you.